Remember, today we're talking about machine learning.
The machines are learning? What? Well, it's a good thing we're here at Lawrence Livermore National Laboratory, where we're surrounded by lots of really smart experts who can tell us a little bit more about what machine learning is and how it works. Let's go talk to them.
Hi, Barry. How you doing?
Hi, Maren. Nice to see you again.
Good to see you.
Right, okay, so what is machine learning? It's the name that we use to describe the field of study that is all about teaching machines to do tasks instead of having to program them explicitly. Let's take, for example, that you wanted to detect images of cats. Now, this is a recurring meme throughout the machine learning community. So detecting images of cats. So I'm giving you a set of images, and the challenge is to say whether there's a cat in this image or not. The traditional way of computer programming this would be to come up with a set of if-then-else statements.
So an if-then-else statement is like, if this image has whiskers, then it is a cat, or else it is a non-cat.
That's right. Like that. That's right. Okay. So you're saying, does it have whiskers? Does it have a tail? Does it have stripes? Is it furry? Does it purr? So you're bringing all this human intuition into designing those if statements. In the machine learning approach, we're going to provide the machine learning a whole bunch of images of cats and a whole bunch of images that are not cats. And the goal of the machine learning algorithm is to adequately separate the cats from the non-cats automatically, and it is able to automatically update those parameters to reduce its error in making these mistakes.
Oh, okay, so the machine is not only learning to identify what a cat is, but mm-hmm. it's learning to reduce its percentage of times it misidentifies a cat.
That's correct. It's learning with examples. So the more examples that you can give it of cats in various background conditions, the more robust and the better able it's going to be able to discriminate cats from non-cats in all sorts of situations.
I know you mentioned that what we're doing here at the lab is not necessarily identifying cats. Some of the things that we're working on here are so much more complex, like maybe a molecular interaction. Mm-hmm. And so for a situation like that, it would be quite difficult for a human to input all of the potential combinations of things and say, and give the algorithm an if-then-else statement.
So we're applying machine learning across a wide variety of national science and national security applications. And so some of these will include things in the advanced manufacturing world. We're also using it in the National Ignition Facility to help us design interesting shop capsules that we would not necessarily have known how to design before. We're also using this in some of our cancer and drug discovery work, where we're using machine learning to assess or predict the probability that certain drug interactions are going to lead to better outcomes. And that way we accelerate the experimental stage. We don't have to run as many experiments if we know we're looking at high value areas, and that's what machine learning is helping us to find.
Sure.
Now that we've covered some of the basics, we're going to go talk to an expert in additive manufacturing, which is a fancy way of saying 3D printing. The engineers here who do that kind of thing work with novel materials like metals and plastics that we've created, and even biological material, printing parts for pretty much anything. Today we're going to learn how machine learning works into all of that. Hi, Brian.
We have a lot of advanced manufacturing applications, and those include additive manufacturing or 3D printing, as well as another project in which we make small microcapsules, and inside these capsules we can do great things like capture CO2 from the air.
That's so cool. We talked about those last time in the algae video, the microcapsules that capture carbon from
exactly.
the air.
Exactly. We actually make them with not a 3D printing process, but through this microfluidic device where we make these little droplets, and we can make them at 1,000 times a second, but even then we can only make gram quantities. If we really want to extract CO2 from the air, we need to make them in kilogram quantities or even more. And when you have these large quantity or large requirements, you have to have a person watch the system. Their job is to sit and look in a microscope, and that's the state-of-the-art technique. Oftentimes they have to do other things like check email, go other places, and sometimes the system can be in a bad state for so long you have time and material waste.
Okay, so kind of like how Barry was saying that you could tell the algorithm what a cat is and what a cat isn't, and then it could learn to recognize cats,
right.
This program has learned to recognize good and bad states of capsules.
Right, it says, you know, we feed it a bunch of images that we call good,
mm-hmm.
and then we feed it other separate sets of images that are three types of bad. And after we train the algorithm, it is capable of detecting new incoming images and it can do so quite rapidly and without fatigue like a human might suffer. And after it makes some sort of decision about that, either the device continues operating as it is if it's in a good state, or it could trigger some type of response if it actually is deviating from where we want it without the requirement for a human babysitting.
What about things that are being 3D printed? Could the same process be implemented?
Yeah, so what you can think of it as is the current, again, state of the art with 3D printers is you give the 3D printer a set of digital instructions and it follows them blindly. And when something erroneous can happen, it doesn't know that and it just continues on that path. So what we're developing at Livermore are the technologies to look at sensor data, and that could be images of the 3D printing process, it could be temperature sensors, pressure sensors, chemical sensors, a variety of different things to make a decision about the state of the system. And if it's going poorly, fix it. With the future of machine learning, the promise is there to have the algorithm come up with very useful conclusions at an early stage, which would inform the researchers what they need to be doing differently, or how they could optimize their process. And it's ultimately going to be an iterative loop here where machine learning is part of the process of, you know, advancing the state of science.
Surprise! We are now on our way into San Francisco. We are going to the city to talk to an expert about how machine learning can be applied to biological fields, cancer drug discovery, how Lawrence Livermore is involved, and you guys get to come with us.
Good to see you.
So Amanda, we're not at Lawrence Livermore National Lab today.
No.
Can you tell me where we are?
We're in Mission Bay in San Francisco at the headquarters of the ATOM Consortium.
City. Okay, and ATOM, that's ATOM, right?
Mm-hmm.
What does that stand for?
Accelerating Therapeutic Opportunities in Medicine. We're trying to take the drug discovery pipeline, which is normally 6 to 7 years, and shrink it down to 1 year by using the power of big data and high performance computing.
So what you're saying is that when companies are trying to develop medicine for things like cancer, it usually takes them about 6 years to do, you know, does it work in the cells, human trials, is it safe, that kind of thing. It takes 6 years, which is a long time for a cancer drug.
What we're trying to do is take the terminated drug data from pharmaceutical companies. So they try out a lot of different drugs. The ones that end up on the market are one out of a huge number that they tried. What we're trying to do is take that data and create machine learning models that can learn from it. They learn about the structure of the molecules, and they are able to predict whether a given molecule is going to affect a target in the way that it's supposed to, and whether it's going to be safe for the rest of your body.
So obviously taking the drug development process down from 6 years to one would have huge implications for human health and for medicine and for cancer treatment, but what other kinds of effects would that have on the way that we treat cancer and the way we experiment around those drugs?
We're hoping if we can prove that these in silico models are effective at predicting safety outcomes, we can reduce the amount of animal testing that is needed to be done. And especially for safety, because the main thing that we're looking at in safety is how a drug would affect proteins that it's not supposed to affect, so things in your heart or your liver. And so that's general purpose, right? We always want our drugs to be safe, and most of the targets are the same. So whether it's cancer or another disease, it really doesn't matter. The safety aspect is pretty similar. And if we're able to predict that successfully, then there's no reason why we can't do that with other types of diseases as well.
Well, Perry, thank you for waiting.
Hey, welcome back.
We've been all around the Bay Area asking more really cool people about what machine learning is and how they're using it.
Yeah.
And I wanted to bring it back full circle to you, our original expert, to give us a little perspective on where you think machine learning is going and what the future of machine learning looks like.
So I think the big upshot is freeing us to think at a higher level, to basically automate those things that we would tend to pull our hairs and go crazy at. So in the future, with these machine learning algorithms, we can automate those mundane tasks and free the people to do to reason at a higher level.
That makes sense. Thank you for sharing your knowledge with us, Barry. It's been a pleasure.
Absolutely, anytime.
Well, you heard it here first, folks. Machine learning is one heck of a cool tool that is probably not going to cause the technological apocalypse and is making our science even better, even faster, and more efficient. If you have any questions on this topic, please leave them down in the comments below and let us know if you want to see more videos like this and what you'd like us to cover in those videos. Thanks for watching, subscribe to our channel, and we'll see you next time.